Back. A good news story for small businessmen. A story about a small business faced with all the handicaps that the lack of money, government legislation, and the oil crisis of 1975 could put in its way, but which has thrived in spite of it all. Sounds unlikely, you may be thinking, but it's not. It happened, and in the motor industry. Here's Angela Lambert.
One of the biggest attention grabbers at this year's motor fair is this amazing six-wheeled, 240-mile-an-hour, £40,000 car, the Panther 6. Every bit as remarkable as the car itself is the story behind the car, of how one man built up a business from scratch in 5 years, to the point where today he employs 200 people and has a turnover of £3 million. I went down to Byfleet to have a look at the company, Panther Cars, and talk to the man who started it all, Bob Jankel. In his original office overlooking the panel beating shop, I asked him how it all began.
I used to build cars as a hobby, and towards the end of the time in the fashion company that I was working for, one of the cars that I had built, which is the predecessor of the J72,
when you first set up Panther, how much capital did you have behind you?
Well, it doesn't sound very much now, but it seemed a lot then. Business that I had been involved in, the textile business, I had a shareholding in the company, and I started with, I think it was about £7,000 from the shares that I sold there. We increased the mortgage on our house by £10,000, and I got a £3,000 overdraft from the bank. So, you know, we started off with that.
You set up the company with a total of £20,000.
Yes.
In those early days of 1972, Bob's workforce numbered three, himself, an accountant, and one mechanic, Andrew McKenzie, who's still with him. Bob and Andrew were designing and building cars in the garage. By the beginning of 73, there was a staff of 12, and by the end of that year, 25. On the floor of his present factory, three times the size of the first one, and asked if there were ever times when he'd felt like chucking the whole thing in.
You can't chuck it in. You've got the people that work for you. You've got the orders that you've taken from customers. You've got the small suppliers who work for you. It simply isn't on. I mean, it's not realistic. You've just got to go on. You've got to be successful. I've had a great deal of help from my wife. Being experienced in business herself, she has her own interests, business interests, outside Panther, and she's very, very good to use as a sounding board for new ideas, for our figures, our projections.
My own working history had given me a certain amount of financial and economic experience which may have been helpful to him. And anyway, it's always fun to do things if you get on well. Other than that, I think it's down to him.
What sort of sacrifices has it meant for you and your family?
Perhaps the future will bring a little more time for the children, although we have seen between us to spend all our spare time with them. Other than that, I don't think so. Just the fun of it outweighs totally any sacrifices that there may have been.
What do you think are the qualities in you, or indeed in any wife of a businessman, that are most needed?
Calmness. During crisis, an ability to see things historically rather than emotion at the time over that particular crisis, and general support when things are really not going right.
Was there anybody who actually hindered your expansion?
Not really. I wouldn't say hindered. That's a pretty strong word. I would say we were handicapped by the bank. The amount of money that the bank was prepared to make available. We obviously cut our coat to the amount of money that was available from the bank. We have projections, cash flow, budgets, etc. Everything was done on the basis of that and our retained profit. The only thing that is a handicap is the fact that the bank that we were dealing with simply did not treat us any differently from anybody else. I mean, we were an exporter, a big exporter, really, as far as percentage of sales are concerned. And 80% of our sales have been exported. I think the average since we've been in business has been 70% over all the time. And we are not treated as an exporter in any way differently from, for example, having a small supermarket.
Although the company's early success was based on its vintage-style cars, like the J72 and DeVille, one person who dealt with Bob Jankel in the early years, when Panther cars relied as much as possible on British engines and parts, was Geoffrey Robinson, then managing director of Jaguars, and now a Labour MP. Geoffrey Robinson, when did you first come across Bob Jankel?
Well, he walked into my office at Jaguar, a frustrated and rather bitter young man, because we weren't supplying him with engines, and he asked me if I'd be prepared to do so.
This was in the very early days of Panther cars. He hadn't really proved himself. You must have had a lot of confidence in him. Why?
I don't know that I could say that I had a lot of confidence in him. I didn't know him that well, and I'd imagine it's still a pretty tough business for him today. But what I would say is that he showed determination, he showed flair. Here he was, a young man, bitter and frustrated by an attitude I couldn't understand. He was going to such lengths at that time of buying whole E-types and taking the engine out and the suspensions to build his cars. Well, I admired somebody who was prepared to go to those lengths. We reversed the policy, and I think he's made quite a success subsequently.
Early this year, Panther Cars expanded again into this factory. Staff too had grown from 25 to 45, then to 90 the next year, until today the company employs 200 people directly. Bob Jankel's future plans are linked to the sales of his first volume car, a vintage style small sports car called the Lima. For a Panther car, it's cheap, under £6,000, and it's the nearest thing Panther have to mass production. They plan to build 600 Limas this year. To market them, Bob started a joint venture with an American company who will invest the capital that will enable Panther to start up a completely new factory, probably in the West Country, to make Limas for the United States.
I think that the main constraint on small businesses in this country is lack of capital. I mean, we have adequate capital ourselves for what we're doing. But I meet so many other small manufacturers who haven't. Now, if I can give you a very clear example. If I had gone to the bank or bankers or backers with a proposition to put extra money into our company in order to build Limas for the American market, I really don't believe that we would have got it. Now, our American importing company, Buckingham Imports, that is a company that was specially formed only to import our cars. That's the only thing that they do. They made a public offering on the New York Stock Exchange, and they raised $1 million, most of which was to be used for a joint manufacturing venture. Now, there's no way that that could possibly be done in England. It's absolutely, you know, it's dreamland. But the way that the big five banks are set up, I mean, they just will not take any risks whatsoever. And the fact is that other countries abroad with good growth rates, some of that growth rate is directly due to money being much more readily available.
Did you ever try going to the National Enterprise Board or any other government agency for money?
They are very good for big people. And I think this is the thing with a lot of the government help for industry. It is very, very good for large people, but when you're very small and you haven't got a track record, the help really isn't there. Because I believe that by the time ICFC would have been prepared to put money in had we asked for it, then we could have gone anywhere to have got the money. And ICFC would have wanted a share of the company as well, and I suspect that we could have gone somewhere else and got the money without having to give up shares in the company.
That car you saw at the beginning, the Panther 6, was built here in this special workshop. I asked Bob Jankel how and why he designed it.
Well, the Panther 6 was designed as a direct result of something that we call in Panther our hazard list. The senior management have to prepare hazard lists, what I call hazard lists, of their areas, which cover the worst thing that could possibly happen. One was the fact that there was a possibility that one day the DeVille sales may not be leaping forward at the rate that they have done. I mean, they've far exceeded what we expected. And we needed a product that was similar amount of work in order to take up the bodybuilding hours that we have in our bodybuilding company. So we decided to have a survey carried out of what are called the supercars made by Ferrari, Lamborghini and Porsche, and bring out a competitor. Some of our customers who own a number of cars do own those sort of sports cars, and as a result of the survey that we did, we produced the Panther 6.
Bob Berry from Leyland Cars has, since the very beginning, supplied components to Panther. I asked him if he thought the cars were value for money.
They're value for money in that they offer something which is unique, and and they're very well made and they're extremely well finished. I think the professionalism of the construction and the finishing of the vehicles is extremely high. He's been able to change existing designs sufficiently to give them an identity of their own, and therefore, in this respect, you can't value something that is relatively unique. I think the true test will come when he comes up with something which is uniquely of his own design, and whether that will be successful or not, what remains to be seen.
Such as the Panther 6, in fact.
Yes, the Panther 6 is a good example of it. That is a car which will, I think, test whether, in fact, he is an innovator as opposed to a developer of other ideas.
The Panther 6 took well over 3,000 hours to build. I talked to Andrew McKenzie, who's been with Panther Cars from the very start. How many hours have you been working on it now today?
Well, we started at 8 o'clock this morning. I haven't had time to stop yet.
You've worked straight through the night?
Yeah, we've had to, I'm afraid.
You're coming up for 30 solid hours?
Yeah.
That's incredible. Why is it, do you think, that people like yourself are prepared to put in these kind of hours for these cars?
It's like being paid for having a good hobby.
The success which that so-called hobby has brought to Bob Jankel and the men who work for him, and to Panther Cars, whose turnover should top £3 million this year, speaks for itself on this stand at the motor fair. Back at Byfleet, I asked Bob Jankel what were the qualities needed for success.
Once you've got the product, you've got to have adequate finance. And you only know if you've got adequate finance if it's planned properly. So the most important people are the accountants at the early stage, who can do the forward planning, the budgeting, and you must keep to the budget. And if you've got a budget that's been written by the accountants, it's absolutely vital to keep to the plan that they've given you. Because if you don't get out enough cars, for example, here, or you have some sort of problem where you don't make enough profit, well, you can't produce the money that the accountants need to pay the bills at the end of the following month and so on. To start a small company, you've got to have a tremendous amount, or the individuals involved have got to have an enormous amount of stamina and tenacity, because it sounds pretty good, but you never really know what hell it can be until you actually get in there. And then it's you can't really do an about turn. You've got to carry on.
But, I asked Geoffrey Robinson, is this individualistic approach to small businesses now out of date?
No, I wouldn't have thought that. I think as a country as a whole, we need more people who are prepared to risk in the way that he did, to show his sort of determination and enterprise. I mean, the small business sector in the economy as a whole is so important. We must find ways of encouraging them. I'm hopeful the government will be doing this increasingly. It's one of the things that the North Sea oil revenues could be used for. But I think that he set an example here where you can see a market sector with flair and determination he's exploited, and that in itself is a lesson.
The lesson being that even in an apparently unfavourable economic climate, a small business can grow. But does the exclusive nature of Panther Cars make it irrelevant to the British motor industry as a whole?
I have a philosophy that says that as long as there are people available to buy these sorts of vehicles, then the rest of us who are in the more mass-produced end also stand a chance. They set a standard by which everybody else gets judged, and I think Jankel comes into that area.